So I was lying in the crook of Dusty's arm, my head halfway on his shoulder, halfway on his chest. Not any different than the countless other times over the last few decades, except for the fact that just hours before that moment, I had been furious with him. You know, I hadn't seen him in 3 months, and during that time, my life had exploded. I was suddenly out of my 5.5-year relationship that I thought was my forever person. And by virtue of that, I lived in a new home. I didn't have my dog. I suddenly needed health insurance, so I had a new job. I had a new schedule. I had a new commute. I lived in a new neighborhood. I even had some new friends. Everything had shifted, and despite the fact that I had been fucking miserable for those first few months, he didn't show up. And had his mom not flown into Portland that weekend, and I hadn't already agreed months before to meet them at the hotel for dinner and drinks, I'm sure I would have canceled. I was that mad. And, you know, up until that point, Dusty's always been in my life in some way or the other. We first met when I was 16 years old, and it was during the first pivotal shift of my life. So I had moved from my small California town, and I was living in this farming community with my traditional Mormon family. And I got to live with some extended family members to finish out high school in the big city of Denver, Colorado. And I met Dusty that first week of high school. And luckily, we were part of the same small, close-knit friendship circle, and we eventually started dating. And he became my high school sweetheart. And we had lots of fun memories and all the great things that you can do in high school. And despite the fact that he was absolutely my first love, we parted ways at 17. And I can't tell you what it was about Dusty that I always knew I would have this connection, but I'm sure it's why I kept the Dusty and Stefanie box. Now, this is a cardboard box that I started when I was 16, and I'd put all our precious mementos in. And when I look at that box now, it's hilarious because I can take out the photos. Same Dusty as 16, now at 42. Shaggy blonde hair, piercing blue eyes, always had a grin, and always was holding something and like rocking out like a microphone or pretending it was his penis. Same Dusty. There were love letters and poems, and then same Stefanie at 16 as 42. I have this piece of paper that we passed back and forth in our biology class after that first makeout session at the party. Super analytical in my head, like, how do you feel about the weekend? What's gonna happen? What do you think this means? Same uptight Stefanie, absolutely. In that box is the typical high school memories. So there's movie stubs and concert tickets. I have the dried pink corsage from prom. I even have the first Valentine's Day gift that he gave me, which was a box of Godiva chocolates in that gold box. I still have a crumbly little truffle in there. So when I see this box, of course it's a physical memory, but it's always in my closet, wherever I live, whatever apartment, whatever house, whatever state. I look up and I just see it, and I think all the emotional memories that we've had over these last few decades. And while we didn't keep in constant touch right after high school, we always made a point of making some sort of connection. So, you know, you had to call the operator, and then you had to find a distant relative with the last name and track him down. Or a postcard would show up at my mom's house like, hey, Stefanie, crab fishing in Alaska, hope we can get in touch. Or that super progressive website that you found your high school people, not Facebook, but classmates.com. So, Stefanie Brown, where are you? Looking for you. So when I finally saw Dusty for the first time, it had been a little over a decade, and I came up to Oregon to visit. And when I saw him, it was like instant connection. Nothing had changed. You know, we had fun. It was easy. What I remember about that long weekend is driving up to a hillside And we were on the back of his pickup truck on the tailgate, and we were kind of leaning back to back and drinking wine and looking at the ocean and watching the sunset and just catching up about life. You know, over 10 years of twists and turns. And again, we're back to back, and he kind of jumps up and he's like, "But you're fucking gay? Like, how the hell did I miss that?" And we joked, and I, you know, challenged some of his conservative views, taught him about the word queer. And from that moment on, we have stayed in touch, and he has become an integral part of my life, as well as his family. And when I moved to Portland a couple years later, we fell into a routine that we still have now, 12 to 15 years later. So Dusty either comes to Portland to visit, and he'll rent a hotel room in Portland. And we do like nice dinners and cool hipster Portland things like beer festivals or maybe occasional storytelling. But most of the time, I drive to the coast. And so as I'm driving, I stop at the grocery store and I buy groceries for however many days I'm gonna be there. I get to Dusty's, I unpack, I start cooking, and then he comes home for whatever meal, and we're always greeted with a hug, and we just catch up. So whether it's been a week or 2 months, that's what we do. And sometimes we go to the beach, or we end up watching a movie. At the end of the night, he goes to his room, and I go to my room, or the guest room, and he says, "Good night, Steph, love you." And I say, "Good night, Dusty, love you." And in the morning, his alarm clock goes off at 7. I get up, I go to the bathroom, I brush my teeth, and then I go into Dusty's room and I climb in bed with him and we chat some more. Whatever we didn't finish from the night before, usually his business deals. And in that time, since that time, whether a hotel, Dusty's kitchen, the couch, the bedroom, we always had this connection, this physical, emotional connection, completely innocent, deeply rooted in this friendship. And so as I was laying on his chest, I felt such relief because I had been holding all of this pain for 3 months and I hadn't been able to process it with him. And finally, I had. We had gone to dinner that night and I laid it on the table and I let him know how pissed off I was and how miserable I had been and how terrified I was of my future and what that looked like. And he apologized for not being there, and there were tears, and I accepted his apology. But he also was honest, and he let me know what was happening for him. It's not that I didn't know that Dusty had been sick. He's been sick for well over a year. So he has an autoimmune disease called ulcerative colitis. And basically what you need to know is your body attacks itself, your intestines and colon. And the worst part is you lose your bowels whenever. And so for 3 months, despite the fact that he has great care and naturopathic care and all of these things, he had been spiraling. His health just had not been stabilized and he was in his head. So while I had been so mad at him, just wallowing in my self-pity, I realized that really we were at the same vulnerable point in life. We were both 42, we both had solid careers and friends, we both had our core beliefs and value system, so it's not like we were gonna change as people, but what did it mean to think about our future? For me, it didn't even occur to me as I had made my way and processed all of these things with him, career, relationship, investments, finances, family. And we had worked and processed all through my breast cancer journey years before then. So when I was thinking about this vulnerability in the last 3 months, it hadn't occurred to me that there was gonna be a time in my life that I wasn't with my partner. I didn't even comprehend that my future or my dating life would be having to meet somebody and be that vulnerable. What would it mean to be sexy in this breastless person? It overwhelms me, terrifies me. And I get that that's a little bit ridiculous for people, but it's fucking hard. and I'm trying. For Dusty, thank you. For Dusty, how do you date somebody? How do you ask somebody on a date? You know, most people are like, where do we go to dinner? Where do we hang out? And you know, for him, it's like, where are the closest bathrooms? And am I gonna make it on time? So as I was laying there and in the hotel, and I took this deep breath and I just thought, God, life is so hard sometimes. And as I took this deep breath, I can't explain it except for this sensory memory. It was like being covered in a warm blanket. You know, like you find it in your closet and it smells like comfort and home and peace and safety. And I know for me, over those previous months, I had just been such a spiraling wreck that I just like had a moment of calm. And I don't know whether it was the copious amounts of alcohol or whether nostalgia for first love or the fact that I was still reeling from deep heartache, but I looked up and somehow we kissed. And it wasn't like this romantic, new, passionate love or this deep exploration, but it was like the slow, repeated kisses of familiarity with these soft, compassionate kisses. It was like these subliminal messages of strength being sent back to each other, like, I see you. Like, you are perfect. Your flaws, your illness, your scar, you are beautiful. You are worthy of love. And I know for me in that moment, I had been such a head case and feeling so vulnerable. And I had said this before to my friends, like I had felt like I was drowning. And in that moment of exchanges, it was like being underwater and someone just giving you just enough oxygen, this lifeline to make it to the top, like you're gonna be okay. And we woke up the next morning and we were like face to face. We opened our eyes and it took about 2 seconds before we started dying laughing. And Dusty was the first one to talk and he said, thank God we have 26 years of life experience to make up for this awkwardness. And I was like, yeah. And we just cracked up and we got up and we, you know, started the day and we went to breakfast and we met up with his family for breakfast, but we could not make eye contact without cracking up. And we found our way at the corner of the breakfast table and like, maybe a mini makeout session is not the best way to deal with sadness and vulnerability. That was for me, of course, you know. And he's like, are we gonna tell anybody about this? And he's like, hell no. And it was like, okay. So we wrapped up breakfast and it was snowpocalypse, I don't know, 2 or 3. And you know, it was ice and snow and we had walked to the restaurant and we had only got down the street and all of a sudden Dusty had a colitis attack. And you could see it on his face and we're trying to get to the hotel. We could see the hotel, but it's snowy and icy and he goes ahead and I get into the hotel and I can see him at the elevator and I could just tell by his body, like he didn't make it. And we don't talk, we just get into the elevator and we make our way up to the room and we walk in, it's like a routine. He gets into the bathroom and he's stripping and I grab his bag and I throw it into the bathroom and he gets in the shower and I'm taking off my boots and I realize I'm wearing my prosthetics and it's uncomfortable and I shove them in my bag. And I sit on the hotel bed and Dusty comes out and he's clean and newly dressed and he looks a little off. And I have him sit down next to me and there we are, shoulder to shoulder and leg to leg. And he kind of sighs and then he looks at me and says, thanks for kissing on the guy that shits himself. And I was like, thanks for kissing on the titless girl. And he put his leg, you know, or his hand on my leg and I just thought, this is one for the memory box this weekend. It was only about a week later that I got a phone call to share a love story. And I panicked because I thought, love has kicked my ass. And then I thought of that memory box. And I thought, Dusty is my longest love story. And from the outside looking in, right, it's a cute little box. Boy meets girl, girl meets boy. They fall in love in high school, and they have a deep connection for decades. But you've heard the story, right? Our love is definitely outside the box. When I think about most great love stories, they live far outside of a box. And when I think about the world today and how full of fear and hate it has become, it seems so much more relevant to understand that love is not defined by gender or age or religion. It is certainly not defined by sexual orientation or politics or immigration status. So as I think about Valentine's Day, and bless you, everybody who has found your true romantic love. I love that. And it's okay for those of us who are still looking. But when I think about love and I recognize that it is not confined by four walls or any sort of checked box status, and I just remind myself that love and connection are everywhere. And when I start to think about that, and as Valentine's Day comes around, I know that I'm gonna think the world is a lot more hopeful, and I think I'm gonna feel a lot less lonely.